You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, and welcome back to Theater 100, Television, Film, and Theater. My name is Naomi Buckley. I'm the instructor for this course. We are in session 14. We only have two more sessions today and next week before we are done and we are in finals week. So I do want to remind you, we are live and online today. If you're tuning into the broadcast, you can give us a call 1-800-339-1193 for any questions or comments you might have. You can also type your question or comments to askdhtvlive@gmail.com. Before we get started today with our lecture on directing, I do want to address a couple of quick issues. So this lecture was added in because I realized that I didn't have enough lectures in there, so we added this one in. And when I did that last week, or a couple weeks ago, I wasn't able to, at the time, move it to the correct position and relabel it. So some of you, I think, have been confused. You've been emailing me about the Angels in America quiz. That's actually not until next week. So directing is going to be this week. I did announce that last week, but if you maybe missed it, if you weren't listening to the very beginning. Directing is this week, and next week is Angels in America. This week, there is no quiz. There's just a discussion board. Next week, there is a quiz on Angels in America. It'll be the very last quiz you take in this course. The quiz, I think, was not open until recently, because I think I went in last night or this morning, I can't remember, and I adjusted it. It will now be open until next Sunday. If for some reason it was open and you took it and you want to take it again, that's all right, because remember, you can take it as many times as you want until the due date is closed. So if for some reason you were obviously confused, as one would be from the way that it was in Blackboard, don't worry about it. Or if you got the score that you want, then that's fine too. There is no quiz this week, so you don't need to worry about that, but you will need to do the discussion board for this week. I do need to pop into the discussion board and make sure that the dates and all of that are correct. I didn't do that. If for some reason directing is not open and available as a discussion board this week, don't worry. I will open it and I will give you extra time to complete it, probably into next week sometime. So it won't be due on Sunday as usual, just because of the confusion. Okay? But it will not exempt you from it. You still will need to do the discussion board. I'll go ahead and post an announcement, and I'll make sure that it's all clear. And again, I'll extend the due date on that discussion board, but you will need to complete a discussion board for this week. No quiz, but definitely a discussion board. Next week, discussion board and a quiz. If you already completed the discussion board for Angels in America, because you were, again, confused as one might be, then you've already got it done. And all you have to do is do the directing one. You will have watched the lecture today, and I'm sure it will be very easy for you to then contribute for directing. There is a chapter associated with this lecture today, so please make sure you read that in your textbook. Even though there isn't any quiz associated with it now, there will be questions on the final exam regarding directing. So you want to make sure that you've read the chapter and you're familiar with what the book has to say about directing as well. On the other hand, for Angels in America, there is no chapter reading. There's just the reading that I assigned to you in the assignments page. There are a couple of links there I want you to follow. You don't need to go and read the play. Next week, we'll be watching some clips. You will need to watch the lecture. It will be difficult for you to be successful on the quiz if you don't, unless you've already watched the play before, the HBO limited series, unless you watch the lecture and either have watched or read the play before. Okay, so, but you don't have to read the play. If you watch the lecture and you do the readings that I've assigned, you should be able to get a great score on the quiz. Okay, so hopefully that clarifies everything. If for some reason there's any more questions, you guys can always email me. You can also type in and ask a question here if you'd like it answered on air if you're watching right now. That's perfectly acceptable. But of course, that brings me to our extra credit question of the day. On the extra credit question of the day is, what are some of the jobs of the director? And do you feel the director is a necessary part of the play production process? So that's the question that we're asking today. What are your thoughts on the director? Are you familiar with any of the jobs that they do? And do you think that they are an important part of the process? And we're going to be talking today in the first part of our broadcast about the history of the role of the director. And then in the last part of the broadcast after our break, we're going to talk about, we're going to look at some modern directors, and we're going to kind of compare and contrast to modern directors in the theater world today. So I think it's an interesting lecture we have for you today. But that's our extra credit question. Feel free to call in or type in your response to that for your extra credit. All right. Well, today, in the first part of the broadcast, we're going to be talking about the history of directors in the theater. We're going to start off by looking at directors before the 19th century, going all the way back to the Greeks and the Romans. The big point is there weren't really any. The word director and the development of that role in the way that it is executed today is a really, really modern invention. And before that, there wasn't any person that really encapsulated all the things that we think of as a director. We are going to talk through some of the things that they did have, each one of these, through these different time periods. None of them, again, really fulfill all of the roles of the modern director, but they did do some of the smaller things that we think of as being the role of the director. So the ancient Greeks had something called the choragus. The choragus was the head of the chorus, and this was the person that often directed and coordinated song and movement for those choral sections. The playwrights probably staged the plays themselves and probably cast them. So the playwrights were the ones who were directing. I know, I don't want to use that word because that's not what they did. They were staging the plays themselves and they were casting them. But what do we mean by staging for the Greek period? And this is going to be relevant throughout pretty much everything all the way up into the 19th century. Well, mostly what these playwrights did was that they simply choreographed entrances and exits for the actors. That was it. So they just told them where to come in and where to go off. They may have also contributed some insight into, you know, the characters and what they were trying to communicate through their play, but it wasn't in the way that we think of it today. There may have been some vocal coaching and, you know, asking them to be louder or more expressive, but again, not in the same way that we think of it today, not in the vein of trying to be realistic or express realism. More in the style of, if you might think of like in a speech class or a forensics class, where we're asking you to be nice and loud just so that you can be heard. And we are thinking about articulation and all that, but we're not thinking about creating realistic, nuanced characters that have subtext and all this other stuff, right? And they would also have, again, choreographed or staged the entrances and exits of the actors. But there would be no other movement that the actors would be doing anyways. They would come into a scene, they would stand in one place, they would say their lines, and at the end of that scene, they would exit. And so they needed to know where they were coming in and where they were exiting. But other than that, there wasn't any what we would call blocking, right? So blocking is actor movement. That's something that now falls under the purview of the director. Usually good directors work with the actors to create that blocking, but it is the final say of the director where the actors move, where they come in, where they go out. And because the director is looking at all of the actors and all of the action of the play, they're really the best person to do that. And because in today's plays, there's a lot of movement that actors do, right? So the person that kind of coordinates all that is the director. But at this moment in time, we have a playwright. He is casting the play. He is telling the actors when and where to come in and where to exit. He or she is maybe giving them some instruction in vocal work and maybe some insight into the text. But other than that, that would be their job. Because of this, you can see that the rehearsal time for these types of plays would have been very, very limited. They weren't, you know, nowadays a show will rehearse anywhere, if we're looking at community theater and educational theater, 5 to 6 weeks for a straight play, 7 to 10 weeks for a musical. If we're looking at the professional world, 3 to 4 weeks for a straight play, 5 to 6 weeks for a musical. Of course, that's because they can be there for 8 hours a day, right? And I'm talking about rehearsal in terms of the play is already written, already polished, it maybe already exists, and now we're just staging it and rehearsing it. But at this point in time, plays would rarely rehearse more than 2 weeks. And sometimes when we look forward into Shakespeare's time, if it was a new play, if it had never been done before, then definitely you'd take a couple weeks to rehearse it. But if it had been done before, then you'd have a couple days. A couple days to rehearse it and stage it, and then it'd be going up, right? So very limited rehearsal time, but also very limited production in terms of not a lot of sets, not a lot of costumes or props, certainly no stage lighting or really a lot of sound, right? And not a lot of concern with realism and realistic movement, realistic acting, all of those things were not important at the time. So, of course, that's why they could have this compressed time period. We know too little to know whether or not the playwright actually, in the Greek period, actually created some kind of unified production, but that which is what the director does today. But again, we do know that they did fill these basic functions of basically casting and staging the play for the spoken parts. A little bit forward in time, we look at the Romans, and there we get a wealthy citizen who organized the plays, but we still don't know whether or not they were there to create a unified production or if they were simply there to, again, cast the play and then give a tiny bit of instruction to the actors and give them their entrances and exits. Of course, right after after Rome fell, we get a huge dark period, and we don't get theater for a very, very long time. But towards the end of the medieval era, when we're getting those morality plays and the mystery plays, we get somebody called the Master of Secrets. And the Master of Secrets was a special effects expert, because there were, of course, many special effects that were in those medieval mystery plays. As I told you, they were sticking pig's guts inside of their shirt costumes so that when they had these battles, they could be cut open. It would look like they had been disemboweled. They had real fire and smoke and sound effects and all kinds of great things that they were doing. We also had someone called the Keeper of the Register. The register was actually the word they used for the master copy of the script. Again, keep in mind, this is a time when we don't have printing presses. We don't have the ability to mass produce the written language. Anything that's being produced is being reproduced by hand, right? And so that takes time. And you certainly don't want to lose it or get it burned. You can't then go to your computer and pull up a backup copy, right? Or go get the Xerox version that you have. If something that was written down was destroyed or burned in some way, that might be the only copy you have of that script. Well, let's cross our fingers that somebody had it memorized really well, because then that would be the only way to then recreate that script, right? So the register, the person, the keeper of the register, the person who kept the original script, the master copy, was a very important job. We also had a guild, which was a group of craftsmen during the medieval period that would hold on to the register and then pass it down from generation to generation so that the play could be done again. Well, with the rise of professional acting companies during Shakespeare's time, we also got the development of what we call the actor manager. And the actor manager was somebody who managed the entire theater company. Maybe was also a manager, also an actor, but then also was kind of the director as well. So they would cast the shows, they again would coordinate all the entrance and exits for the actors, they might give some instruction about how to say the lines. But even during Shakespeare's time, we do not have actor movement on the stage. We don't have real blocking in the way that we understand it today. That's not to say they just stood there like rocks and they never moved, but the movement was incredibly limited. It was maybe you take a few steps over, maybe there's one action you do, you get down on a knee, or you pretend to stab yourself or something, you walk a few steps to see the ghost of your dead father. But there certainly wasn't this type of complicated movement on the stage that we have today. It was still very much actors come in through a particular doorway, and they're there for the duration of the scene. They move very little, and then they exit out. But there was still a necessity to have someone that would do that. And in this role, we do know that the actor manager also tried to create some sort of unified feel for the piece. In other words, they were coordinating all the different aspects of the production. There weren't very many props, but they would still be in charge of making sure that the props were procured and it was the type of props that they needed, and that the actors had, again, not very much costume, but if there was something limited like a crown or a sash that somebody needed, they would make sure that they had those things. They would make sure that the music came in at the right time and all of that. So again, we're talking about unification, a unified kind of production, but in a sense that is much more rudimentary than what a director does today in terms of creating the vision of a piece and unifying the piece. Today, it's got many, many more moving parts, right? Well, if we move ahead in time, what we see is Molière. We get into the 18th century, and Molière is probably one of the first, there are others as well, we're going to talk about them, but one of the first people to really take on more of what we consider a modern role as a director. He was an actor, he was a producer, he was obviously a writer, we've talked about him as a writer, and he was also a director. He was very meticulous about his productions. He was very well known for being very strict and hard on his actors and requiring great deals of rehearsal for them, which was very unusual, right? He was very concerned with all the elements of production. Again, there's still very limited amounts, different things that are here. We don't still have a lot of props. We don't have a lot of set pieces, but he was involved with all those aspects. And since a modern director is someone that we see as being involved with all those aspects today, we kind of look at him as not necessarily the first director, but certainly the, one of the first people that we see that is starting to think beyond just actors' entrances and exits and making sure that all the right things are there. He's actually thinking about the bigger look of the show, and because he was often the writer of the show as well, what is the overall intention of the piece and how are we going to bring that out through all the different elements on stage? Another person who's in this line of people in the past that are kind of contributing to the development of the modern director is David Garrick. David Garrick was an actor manager, again, of the Drury Lane Theatre in London from 1747 to 1776. And he was also known to be very strict with his actors. He required a large amount of discipline from them. He even had a conduct book that he wrote that each one of them had to read before they were allowed to perform in his company. His innovations included that there would be no audience on the stage ever, including any nobles or royals that wanted to be on the stage. Up until that point, it had been super customary that if somebody showed up at your theater and they happened to be a lord or a lady, or even just someone who had a lot of money, you would allow them to sit on the stage with the actors. It was a place of honor. It was, of course, the best seat in the house. It was also the best place to be seen, right? There was no mistaking that, you know, Lord Habersham is here tonight, right? But he believed that that was a distraction for the audience from watching the play, and he banned all audience from the stage, which was a huge deal. He also was known for implementing a more naturalistic style of acting. Let's make the caveat there that this would be for the time period. If we saw it today, we'd probably still think, wow, that's really over the top and overly dramatic. But up until this moment, it would be considered much more naturalistic than what we had seen before, which again would be very declamatory, very expressive, to the point of where a modern audience would think of it as a lot of overacting, right? So he really asked that his actors kind of pull back on that and create a more naturalistic style. Again, we might see it and still think that it was bad acting over the top, but at the time it would appear to be much more subdued than what they had seen in the past. He also had a focus on the importance of scene design, that the set and what was designed for it, what was painted for it, and the pieces that came on were an integral part of telling the story. And again, this was not something that a lot of people had been concerned about before. And here we see again the further development of what the role of the modern director will be. Today, as I just did yesterday, it would be absolutely unheard of for a director to direct a show and then not meet with their scenic designer long before the set was designed. So I'm going to be directing next semester. So that's, you know, 3-4 months away now. But I yesterday already met with my set designer and we talked through what our ideas were and what we were thinking of and a basic rough sense of what the space will look like. Today, I would be shocked if I walked into a directing job and the set had already been designed. You know, it is part of my job as a director to give input into that. And a director has a different sensibility and they have a particular vision. There's things that they want to say with a piece that is important that it also be expressed through the set design. The set is this enormous thing. It is the stage that the actors play on. And if I have a particular idea, theme, motif that I want to express to that, and somebody else has already designed the set with a completely different idea, then my God, you know, you've taken half of my job away from me, right? And half of my creative expression. So for Garrick to really focus on this was, again, another kind of leap forward in what the modern director would do, what they would become, and what their concerns would be. He was considered a director in his day, but then they used the term producer, which is still used by many in England today to indicate director. Another person that we might consider one of the very first in this line of burgeoning directors that lead to the modern director is Johann Wolfgang von Goethe. You may have heard of that name Goethe, and you may have thought that it was pronounced Goethe or Goethe, but it's actually pronounced Goethe. I know it's weird, but it's German, and that's the way that they pronounce it. So Johann Wolfgang von Goethe was alive 1796 to 1807, and he was a really huge part of what's called the Weimar Classicism, and this was a German version of Classicism that, you know, they all kind of had, the French had their Neoclassicism and the Germans had their Classicism. Again, going back to the Greeks and Romans, but then modifying it to their own culture and tastes. He was very strict. And he, again, like as you can see with a lot of these people, right? He demanded a lot of his actors. He wanted to have his hands in everything. He mistrusted other talent. He didn't want anyone to handle his productions except him. And because of that, again, his kind of controlling nature, that he did a lot of things and was involved with a lot of aspects of production that people had not been involved in before. And again, we see this kind of building up to all the roles that the director will fulfill later on in modern history. The last one on our list, as we're moving into the 19th century, is the Duke of Saxe-Meiningen. And the Duke of Saxe-Meiningen was around from 1826 to 1940. We do consider him, look, he's an interesting looking man, isn't he? Quite grizzled with a large beard. He was the first modern director. Oftentimes when you hear about people talk and they say, well, who was the first modern director? This is the guy who comes up, the Duke of Saxe-Meiningen. Even though we've just talked about three other important people throughout history who contributed, and who had ideas, obviously, and were fulfilling some of the roles, the Duke of Saxe-Meiningen is probably the only person that we see that really takes on all of the different aspects of modern directing and is there to create a really unified vision for a piece. He toured his company around Europe. He was independently wealthy. He was obviously a noble. He was a duke. And he was independently wealthy, and there was any number of things he could have done with his life, but he had a great love of the theater. And so he took this on. Because he had enormous wealth, he was able to do things without having to have patrons and without having to have the input of other patrons. And so he was able to kind of run things in the way that he saw fit. And he made a lot of innovations. First, he had a great focus on realism. He wanted realistic and accurate historical costumes and sets. He went to great lengths when he was producing something that was from history or was supposed to be set in a historical time period to reproduce those costumes authentically. He would pay enormous amounts of money to have them sewn authentically and that they should look absolutely authentic and that the sets should look absolutely authentic. He also used a pictorial style, which is something that we strongly see today in modern directing. It's an important part of modern directing. What does that mean? That the modern director is thinking about focus and composition for the stage so that they are creating, they are putting people on the stage, not just so that they can be seen by the audience, not just so that they can be heard by the audience, not just so that the audience knows that they are on the stage and they are actors, but they're actually creating artistic pictures with the people on the stage. So if you think of an artist has lots of different mediums to paint with. They might be an oils painter or an acrylic painter. They might be a watercolor or gouache painter. The director paints with actors. And they use other things too. They have a lot of different tools in their box. They're obviously working with the set designer to help color the set out with that and with light and sound. But actors really are the primary medium that the director works in. And they are putting those people on the stage in a really specific way to create not just beautiful pictures, but also to make sure that the audience knows where to look, who's the most important person in this scene, and also to reinforce the central visual motif. So maybe there is something about, I'll just go back to the play I recently did because it's the most on my mind right now, Radium Girls. There was a lot to do. One of the big themes was time, running out of time, and that clock, the idea of a clock face became a really, really important visual motif. And so placing actors on the stage in ways that emphasized that, that made them look as though they were in this kind of circular clock face or that they were at certain points in time, and arranging them in ways that emphasized that was important to the staging of that piece. He was also really known for his really large crowd scenes and for those crowd scenes being especially well composed. So again, he's not just throwing a bunch of people on stage, right? Anyone can throw a bunch of people on stage. You know, I could tell 20 people to go climb onto stage and inevitably they'll all stand in some kind of a line or lines, right? But to actually put people on the stage and make it look interesting and use what we call different levels, meaning we don't just have everyone all standing or all sitting or all laying down, right? Or all on one level. To create an interesting visual image that leads the eye somewhere and draws focus and automatically leads the audience to look where they're supposed to look is actually a skill. And it is something that directors work with a lot and that they're continually focused on in terms of creating stage pictures that are pleasing to look at, that reinforce the central themes and images of the play, but that also create the correct focus. So he was doing all of these things. He was highly involved in props and sets and costumes and the composition and the way the actors were acting and casting and all of that. And because of that, we do consider the Duke of Saxe-Meiningen the first modern director. Well, we're gonna move forward now in time to our 20th century directors. There are a slew of them. Now at this point, we're jumping ahead. We now have the position of director solidified in the minds of the theatrical world, right? That there should be this position. There should be someone who is a director who coordinates all of these elements together, creates a unified production, has a singular vision, and creates that through the production. And so we get a bunch of different types of directors that evolve in the 20th century who are fulfilling this role. Andre Antonin is one of them. He was alive from 1858 from 19 to 1943. He ran the Theatre Liber and was involved with creating the Theatre of Cruelty, which we've talked about. He had a really specific idea. He wrote and directed and was highly involved in all of the productions, all the elements of productions. He was all about shaking the audience out of their passivity by creating real physical sensation in the audience, and often that might involve presenting them with disgust or shocking them, right? All of these things so that they would be thinking about the larger themes of the piece. Otto Brahm, from 1856 to 1912 in Germany, he was involved with the Freie Bühne, which is the free stage in Germany. And this was a very experimental theater that was experimenting with all sorts of different forms of new things. He was highly involved in all the aspects of production there. Again, he ran the theater, but he was also the guy who directed all of the productions there. J.T. Gein in 1862 from 1938, he ran the Independent Theater in London. And Konstantin Stanislavsky from 1863 to 1938, the Moscow Art Theater, which was founded in 1898, which he ran with Vladimir Nemirovich Danchenko from 1858 to 1943. They were co-founders. They ended up eventually splitting and kind of going two separate ways, but they both were strongly, and we've talked about Stanislavsky before, obviously, strongly grounded in ideas of realism, creating naturalistic sets, creating naturalistic performances, creating naturalistic soundscapes, and their whole thrust was creating a vision of realism for the modern theater. Of course, there are tons of others that evolved that are important. We certainly don't have time to cover all of them. I'm going to talk about a few of them right here and kind of go through, but Edward Gordon Craig, Vsevolod Meyerhold, who actually worked with MAT for a while and then went his own way and started focusing more on physicality and physical expressions rather than realistic expressions for the theater. We did see a set of his and talked a little bit about him a session or two sessions ago. David Belasco, Max Reinhardt, Tyrone Guthrie, Elia Kazan, who ran the group theater in the 1930s. They were kind of an offshoot off of Stanislavski's closed system. Out of there came Uta Hagen and Stella Adler and a bunch of other people that were highly focused on creating, again, realistic performances for the stage. And Elia Kazan was also a mentor, a critic, and a therapist of actors. As I said, he used Stanislavski's inner technique and psychological realism. There was, of course, a controversy in 1999 where he received the Lifetime Achievement Award because, but he was sort of disliked in the theater world and in the film industry because of HWAC, which stands for the House Committee on Un-American Activities, which was ran by Senator McCarthy, where, I don't know if we talked about this or not in this class, but basically in the 1950s when there was the Red Scare and people were afraid of Russians, one of the things that some people got in their mind was that the Russians were trying to infiltrate America through the film industry and that they were hiring and subsuming people in the film industry to kind of write films and create films that would celebrate communist ideals in a very subtle way, right? And Senator McCarthy became kind of obsessed with this idea that the Russians were trying to infiltrate America and turn Americans towards communism. And he started the HWAC, which again stands for the House Committee on Un-American Activities. And they held a series of hearings where they brought in a ton of people from the entertainment industry. And it was a really, really difficult situation because you would be brought in to testify at this committee. Now, keep in mind, I think a lot of us maybe know more about this than maybe other people because of recent events. But if you're called to testify in front of Congress, this is like testifying in front of a judge in a courthouse. If any of you watched William Barr's testimony or Jim Comey's testimony, Michael Cohen's testimony that was broadcast live recently, you know, one of the first things they have you do is be sworn in. And just like in a court of law, you are asked to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth. And if you lie to Congress, that is a felony offense. You can be put in jail for that. That's a criminal offense, right? So these people were called to testify in front of Congress under oath about whether or not they knew any communists or they were involved with communist activities. And the problem was that if you didn't name names or you didn't say that you knew this was going on, then you would be looked at as probably you were lying. They thought, well, you're lying. And you're trying to cover up for all these people that you know that are involved in communism. So a lot of people went on the stand and sold their friends out and lied, said things that weren't true. But there were also people that were card-carrying communists, Trumbo being one of them. There was a wonderful film that Bryan Cranston stars in that's all about him. And he wasn't certainly a Russian operative. He was just a guy who had a different belief about economic systems. But he and a bunch of others refused to testify. Now, if you refuse to testify or answer questions in front of Congress, you can be held in contempt of court. That's also a criminal act, and you can be put in jail. Trumbo was actually put in jail with a bunch of his associates because they refused to answer questions, and they certainly refused to say anything else about anybody else that they knew about. So Elia Kazan, on the other hand, that's a long explanation for you to understand basically that Elia Kazan kind of gave into the pressure for a variety of reasons. People were also being blacklisted. If you were named as a communist, you could be blacklisted in the film industry. You wouldn't get any work. People wouldn't hire you, and you'd be out of a job. If you've heard that phrase before, damned if you do, damned if you don't, you know. If you didn't name names, they were going to think you were lying and this air of suspicion would hang around you. If you did name names, everyone in your industry hated you, but you know, you were not obviously not a communist, you know. So it was a very difficult situation. Elia Kazan, as I said, did name names, and so there was a lot of controversy over him winning the Lifetime Achievement Award because he kind of sold out some of his friends. It's also kind of an interesting note in history that Elia Kazan and Arthur Miller were actually really good friends. And Arthur Miller certainly wasn't a communist, although he might have been a communist sympathizer, but he wasn't a communist. But Arthur Miller was strongly disturbed by the HWAC committee, as so many people were. And he felt like it was to use a term that's certainly overused today, it was a witch hunt. It was just fear driving this panic and mania to seek out wrongdoing where there was none, and to force people to confess to things or turn over people that had done nothing wrong. And because of that, Arthur Miller wrote The Crucible. And because Arthur Miller and Elia Kazan were actually very close, Elia Kazan had, was kind of part of that process and impacted his writing of that. And they kind of disagreed, even though they were friends, they disagreed over a lot of things about that. The Crucible, if you didn't know, and we are going to talk about that later, is a play that was written by Arthur Miller, and it goes back to the Salem witch trials, but it's absolutely an allegory for what was happening in the 1950s with the HWAC committee and McCarthyism. So there's just kind of an interesting, if you ever look at The Crucible or read the opening, almost any version of The Crucible has a really long introductory prologue that talks about the development of this play and what Arthur Miller was thinking and all the research he did. Elia Kazan is mentioned quite extensively throughout there and sort of the discussions and his thoughts and his wife's thoughts on the play and so on and so forth. All right. Well, after World War II, we get the development of what we call the auteur director. You may have heard this term before. What is an auteur director? An auteur director is someone who brings their own thoughts and feelings to the film or play and imbues it with their own very specific worldview. Some of the stage directors that we would consider auteur directors are Jerzy Gutowski, Peter Brook, and Richard Schneider. Schneckner. And of course, you may be more familiar with this term in terms of film directors. There are lots of auteur film directors out there as well. We've talked a little bit about this before, but I'll mention again. I really feel like when you look at an auteur director's piece, you even if you didn't know, you would see it come up on the screen, you would watch a couple frames, and you would go, ah, this has got to be X director, right? their vision is so clear, their style of directing is so clear, you immediately recognize their style, their voice, the visual elements that they typically incorporate. So, you know, people like Oliver Stone, people like Quentin Tarantino, people like Spielberg and Wes Anderson, all these people fall into that auteur director kind of thing where you see their pieces. And a lot of these people as well, as I'm talking, you might notice that a lot of these people, not all of them, but a lot of them also tend to write their own pieces, right? They write it, they direct it, they do everything. They've got, you know, an entire vision. And because of that, it comes out with a really, really specific look and feel, right? There are wonderful film directors out there that direct lots of things, but when you see their pieces, their style is much more subtle and adaptive, and maybe it adapts more to whatever the story is that they're telling, or the people that they're working with, or the genre that they're working in. And because of that, their style is, it's not that it's bad, it just doesn't have that really specific vision. You can be a stage director and not have a very specific look or feel to your pieces as well. There are plenty of great stage directors that don't have that kind of look. I tend to fall more in that. I don't really have a specific one thing that I like to do. It's really more about what does the piece require, right? And I adapt to that. But with auteur directors, they're really asking the piece to adapt to them, and they will make it conform, right? And that's why a lot of them write their own pieces. But it certainly is wonderful to watch a director like this work. Their vision is so specific, and if you enjoy their vision, then it's really, really fun to watch their pieces. I happen to love Wes Anderson, and I love watching all of his films. He's got a really specific voice, a really specific vision and look for all of his pieces. And, you know, when you watch something by Wes Anderson, there's no mistaking that it's Wes Anderson, right? And these play directors have very, very similar ways of approaching their work. And in a moment, when we get to the second part of the break, we're going to talk about two really modern directors who also are doing that in their own way today. Well, let's talk just a little bit about each one of, not each one of these, but I think we do talk about all of them. I want to talk a little bit about Jerzy Grotowski. Grotowski worked under Stanislavski. He was really kind of his heir apparent after Stanislavski died. What's really interesting is that Grotowski really takes what was developed in Stanislavski's method towards the end of his career and then expands it and really makes it bloom out into something completely different. It's almost as if when you think about Grotowski's work and you look at what he did, it is almost the diametrical opposite of what you think of when you think of Stanislavski. And it's certainly the opposite of what you see in terms of what people like Elia Kazan, Stella Adler, and Uta Hagen took out of Stanislavski's work, right? They were also kind of protégés underneath him, but they took a really different tact. Whereas Grotowski, who had more contact with him towards the end of his life, more insight into his work and the things he was thinking towards the end of his life, tended to blossom out and explore the other aspects of his work. And what were those aspects? Well, it was very, very physically grounded. It was about external exploration as a key and a doorway into internal exploration. And because of that, his pieces were very environmental. They were very immersive. They were all about, primarily about actor movement. Many of them were what we would call devised pieces, meaning that they were pieces that he worked like intensively with a small group of actors, and they came up with an idea. Maybe the idea was love. Maybe the idea was hate. Maybe the idea was apocalypse. And then they would improvise out what this play was going to be based on those ideas, right? And they would be told primarily through the physical, not so much verbal aspects, and they would devise an entire piece around that idea. So he's well known for Faustus and Acropolis, and these again were pieces that were really, really immersive and very much about themes, big themes, rather than necessarily narratives. Peter Brook is also, he's an English director, really, really well-known auteur director. He's two of his big pieces that he was well-known for was Midsummer Night's Dream and the Mahabharata. The Midsummer Night's Dream that he's most well-known for was just if you ever look it up, crazy, insane production, beautiful, absolutely stunning vision for it. He basically had the entire set was like this white, think of it as a white cube, right? But the audience is on one side, so the fourth wall is invisible. So it's a cube missing one side. Inside of that cube were swings and clouds. There we go. these beautiful platform clouds. And all, look at this, these actors sitting on this cloud right here. I'm guessing that's Tatiana and Oberon, maybe Puck on the side there. But you can see there's entrances and exits, there's doorways, but it was basically just one giant white room. And the color was all brought in through these individual little clouds and stuff in the costumes, but it was, I don't know how to describe, a giant white room with hanging platforms and swings. There were literal swings that the actors could swing on. I think there was a pool of water, or maybe there was something they brought on, but really visually engaging, very, very different than what you would think of as a Midsummer Night's Dream, but very, very visionary. And obviously that came out of Peter Brook's imagination. He saw that, he kind of created that, he saw the whole of that, and then he made it happen in that space, and that was kind of the thing that put him on the map. After that, he did the Mahabharata. The Mahabharata actually toured for many, many years. This was a project that took many years for him to complete. The Mahabharata is actually a sort of religious, mythical text out of India, and it's stories of like a religious text would be. It's stories about gods, and it's parables and all kinds of things. And basically, Brooks went to India and learned all about it and learned all about the stories and saw the traditional performances of the different aspects of this. And then he basically created a play that told the entire story of the Mahabharata. And it was, you can see a picture here. This is way it was traditionally performed, was outdoors. And the audience would be seated either on rocks or on these rugs that would be seated outside. And it was all done outside. There was lighting that was brought in and all that. But it was intended to really feel very immersive, like you were being transported back in time in a way, a magical thing where you would suddenly hear this religious text. Imagine like the whole Bible coming to life, but you kind of feel like you're in Noah's Ark hearing it, and you're out in the desert of, you know, you're by Galilee when you hear the story. And he worked for a very long time on this piece, and it got huge amounts of acclaim. Apparently, I've never seen it, seen parts of it, but very, very beautiful production that was very, very engaging. I want to read, I have a little bit of some text here from the New York Times about what this production looked like, and I think it will give us some insight into what it was like to attend this production and see this production being performed. The New York Times say, in Avignon, Mr. Brooks' theater was an open limestone quarry. Outside the city, where spectators sat on scaffolding facing massive boulders, rose-tinted cliffs 100 feet high, and a vast playing space filled with tons of luminous yellow sand. A canal of real water, constructed by the technical director, Jean-Guy Licat, flowed across the back of the space. A small pond reflecting the action was down front. At one side was an altar-like arrangement of low-burning flames and Indian garlands. At the other, the percussion, string, and wind instruments for the musicians who each night improvised the music and became an integral part of the action. When it grew dark, the lighting transformed the rock, water, sand, and cliffs to gold yellow, deep beige, and slate blue, so that the terrain appeared as a unifying image in a dream expressing the enigmatic, primitive beauty of the elements. So, sounds pretty magical, right? Something really beautiful about him doing what we would call kind of a found space or a site-specific piece, where we take the audience, we don't put them in a theater, we actually take them to a place that is very much like where the play would be, right? And we ask them to sit in this space with us. And that, I think, transforms the role of the audience. They are spectators, but now they are almost part of the space as well. And they are part of the entire play. And it turns it into, again, taking it back more to those ritual elements of where theater really began, this feeling of being in sacred space where not just art is being performed in front of you, but almost like these spiritual rituals, the storytelling that has meaning and this conjuring that's happening that is really beautiful about what he did with the Mahabharata. All right, we're going to read. Jennifer has written in today to answer our extra credit question of the day. I do want to read that on air. And then we're going to take a short break. And then when we come back, we're going to talk about the modern director's roles, as well as look at a couple of modern directors and compare and contrast them. So the question of the day is, what are some of the jobs of the director, and do you feel the director is a necessary part of the play production process? And Jennifer's written in. She says, some of a director's jobs consist of making decisions about the script, as well as choosing what the characters look like, including the scenes. The director, of course, is necessary because they make sure everything runs smoothly and perfectly. Without a director, no one would be guided. Yeah. Well, today, you're absolutely right, Jennifer. Thank you so much for typing in. Today, there are so many different elements of production. You know, we have these realistic sets that we're supposed to have, and we have these props and costumes and lights and sound, all these elements that really nobody had before the 19th century. And then some of that wasn't even had until, you know, the middle of the 20th century. And so we have so many different elements that today it really is necessary to have a singular person who can be the central point and unify all those elements so that we don't have costumes that look like they're one thing and a set that looks like it's a completely different thing, right? And sound that sounds like it's from a completely different place. So because of that, we do find it necessary to have this person who unifies all those things. And yes, they are responsible for that. And when we get back, we're going to talk more about what the director's roles are. And then, like I said, we're going to look at a couple of modern directors and kind of compare and contrast their styles and see what's happening today in the directing world. All right, we'll take a 5-minute break. And when we come back, we'll continue on talking about the role of the director.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The soup is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives us confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it, the results are better academics, more social, a better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
My name is Zanaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mara Briones, and I'm a junior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm a business major, and the reason why I chose this campus was because of its location and good business program.
Hello, and welcome back to Theater 100. In this last part of our broadcast today, we're going to be talking about the roles of the modern director, the skills that a modern director needs to be successful, and we're going to compare and contrast two modern directors, Julie Taymor and Ivan Van Hove. I do want to, before we get going, remind you we are live and on air. And if you want to type in with a question or comment, a call, I welcome you to do that. You can give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. You can always type a question or comment to askthtvlive@gmail.com. And of course, you are more than welcome to type into our extra credit question of the day, which is, what are some of the jobs of the director, and do you feel the director is a necessary part of the play production process? So you have until the end of the episode. If you'd like to get some extra credit, type in. I'd love to hear your responses. So we've gone through time. We've looked at some directors of the late 20th century, and we're going to take a look at what are some of the modern director's roles, what are some of the things that they do, and then what are some of the skills that they need to have in order to be successful at their job? Well, the modern director really does all kinds of things. I mean, we could talk for two lessons about what are all the things that I do when I direct a show. But we're just going to go through some of the most important ones briefly. One of the things that a director does from the very start is they may choose the piece that they're going to direct, as I get to do here when I'm at Dominguez, or they may not do that. They may simply be given the piece they're going to direct and then read it and interpret it. There's nothing that's invalid or more valid about either one of those things. It just depends on the director. It's fun as a director to be able to choose the things that you're going to work on, but there's also something to be said about being given something and having to find meaning and interpret something based on somebody else's choice. So it just depends on where you're working and what the environment is. But either way, a director is then asked to interpret the script. A modern play, or even not a modern play, of course, any play has, any piece of art has many themes that you can suss out of it. And like I like to say in my classes, themes are one of those things, they're very subjective, meaning they come from your internal perspective and they're very personal. And there can be many, many different interpretations that are all correct. They're all in the right ballpark, right? And we can all agree that The Lion King, that some of the themes of The Lion King are probably courage and finding one's destiny and standing up for what you believe is right and being brave and relationships between fathers and sons, right? Seizing the day, right? These are all generally inside of the world of The Lion King, the themes that are discussed in that play, as well as the film, right? Now, I could go way outside and I could say something like, I think The Lion King is about the Russian takeover of the Crimea. That's probably not in the ballpark of what The Lion King is about. First of all, because it was written long before that ever happened. And secondly, there really isn't a lot of evidence in the text to support that. If you're going to make a claim that's really, really far left about a theme in a play, you're going to really take it someplace really, really different, then you really have to have a lot of good textual evidence to support that idea, right? And other research probably to support that idea. But most people aren't jumping so far out of the box. I find that most people tend to gravitate towards the three or four main themes that are relevant within a piece. And the director's job is then to pick which of those themes that they find most important, most relevant, the one that they want to emphasize the most, and bring those out for the audience, right? So that the audience is really able to clearly identify one thing that they feel is important. And that's not to say that they might obfuscate the other elements, it's just that they're not going to focus on them as much. This is why you can see a piece directed by, the same piece directed by three or four different directors, and each one of them can be wildly different. We just looked at Peter Brook's Midsummer Night's Dream. If any of you were lucky enough to get into our wonderful Kelly Herman's production of A Midsummer Night's Dream on campus, completely different in, well, not completely, but very, very different production. That was all white with the colorful costumes. Kelly's production was color everywhere, right? The entire set was color. It was in the round. It was immersive. It was sensual. It was Indian. They were all in Indian costumes, and this and everything had a very Indian feel to it, and I mean East Indian. And so she had a kind of very different take. Her vision was very different. And if I were to direct A Midsummer, again, would be very different. And we can see all the different ways that people can interpret a particular piece. And none of those are wrong. That's what makes it fun to go to the theater and to see the different ways that those stories are interpreted over time and through the individual perspective and vision of the director that's using them. So that's one of the director's main jobs, is to attack that theme, attack that idea, and find the unifying vision for the piece. What is this that we're all going to be rallying around, this one particular idea, and we're going to make sure that all of the elements in the play are kind of pointing to that one feeling or thought. They're also there to cast the actors, to hold the auditions, cast the actors, and choose who they think will make, who will be best in these roles. They're there to work with the design team to create other elements of the production with the use of that unifying vision. So the director is the hub of the wheel. You know, they're the center point, and they're the ones talking with the costume designer and the set designer and the prop designer and the lighting designer and the sound designer and the graphic artist who's creating the posters for the film, I mean for the show. And they're there to say, look, this is my vision, this is what I want everything to feel like, and let's talk about how costumes are going to fit into that idea. Let's talk about how set is going to fit into that idea. Let's talk about how the soundscape is going to fit into that idea. And what is it that we're trying to create here? And let's make sure we're all on the same page, right? Because of that, a director really has to be able to speak many different languages. And I don't mean literally, like, you know, they don't need to speak Cantonese and also Spanish, but they do need to be able to speak in the technical jargon of each one of these designers that they're working with. That really falls under the purview of skills of director, so I'm going to cover a bit more in a bit, but I do want to kind of throw that out there now, that it is one of the things that a director has to be good at. They rehearse the actors. They often, depending on if you're working in a community or educational theater, you're working in professional theater, they also might create the rehearsal schedule. Even if in a professional setting, the stage manager might be the one who actually kind of types that up and keeps it up to date. Even if that is the case, the director has a lot of input in how they want to rehearse that piece. And directors, this is one of those areas too where you find that directors really vary. There's all kinds of ways to approach the rehearsal of a play, and different directors have different things that work for them. I have a particular thing that I've, you know, a system that I've kind of worked out over through trial and error, and that works for me. And other directors approach things from different angles. So it really just depends on the director you're working with. That rehearsal process can be very different depending on the style of director that you're working with. But it is their job to rehearse the actors, to be there every night. And in that rehearsal process, of course, they are indicating actor movement. They are creating, helping to create, sometimes with the actor, sometimes not. Sometimes they're the ones dictating all of the action for the piece, where those actors are coming in, where they're exiting, where they're moving to. And in addition, they're also giving instruction, right? They're doing the directing part of the directing for the actors. They're giving them insight into their characters and helping them develop their characters. They're giving them insight into whether or not they're approaching their acting technique correctly in terms of just being loud enough and being heard on stage and articulating well enough. They're giving the direction on how their character fits into the whole of the play, how this scene fits into the whole of the play. So there's a lot of analysis that actually happens in the rehearsal process. It's not just going over lines. It's not just move here and move there. There's a whole set of things that have to happen in that very, very limited amount of time in order for this entire piece to come together. They're also the person that coordinates all elements of production from pre-production to first performance. The only other person that does this is the stage manager, and the stage manager is really not there to provide vision for the piece, create a vision. The stage manager is there to provide structural and sort of logistical support to the director. The stage manager is the person who is going to help run rehearsal every night. They're going to record the blocking. They're going to make sure that actors are there when they're supposed to be there, that if actors are missing, we find out where they are, that they're alerting and making announcements to actors all along the way, as well as to a creative design team. And once the show is up and running, they will be the one that call all of the cues in the booth. And once the director leaves, they will be the one that takes the show forward all the way to the end. So the stage manager is actually the person, especially in professional theater, that the only person who's there from pre-production all the way to the close of the show. But the only other person who has that much contact with the show, even though it's slightly less, is the director. The director is there from pre-production all the way to opening night. And then a lot of directors, especially in the professional world, will move on to whatever their next thing is. They can't be there for every single performance because they usually have something else. And also at that point, the director's job is done. The director's job is not to then continue directing the show once it opens. In the world of directing, we like to say once the show opens, it's not ours anymore. It's not the director's anymore. It's actually the actors and the audiences now. And it's not our job anymore to continue to be critical or change or adapt or shape it, right? It works a little differently in educational theater because we do have people here that are learning and are trying to still develop. And so I do, and I know some of our other directors do, still give limited, very, very limited direction during the course of a run. But in the professional world, it's really like once the show opens, the director's job is done, and it's really kind of a faux pas for them to continue to be involved past that point, unless it's just there for support. So a director can certainly be involved in terms of supporting the cast and just showing up and being there and watching their continued growth, but really it is out of the hands of the director once that show opens. It is then the stage manager's job to make sure that the show maintains consistency. So the director, actor, and everybody else have worked to create something that looks like this, right? And once the show opens, we want to make sure that it keeps looking like this, that or better, right? But certainly not worse or radically different. And that's really the stage manager's job, is to make sure that actors are still saying their lines the way they're supposed to, still doing that movement the way they're supposed to, that light, sounds, and costumes and all that are being maintained in the way they're supposed to, so that that consistency can continue through all the way to closing. Well, what are some of the skills that the director needs in order to be successful in these roles? Well, first of all, they need to be a fabulous communicator. As I said, the director has to be able to communicate in lots of different languages. The language of the actor, the language of the set designer, the language of the lighting designer, the language of the costume designer, language of the prop master, the language of the public relations person. Each one of these design areas and artistic areas have their own way of speaking and their own way of relating to each other. And it's really important that as a director that you have a handle on what all that means. For people who might be interested in doing this job, at least for the stage, one of the things I always recommend is that as a director, you need to be able, you need to have done everything at least once, right? If you're gonna, in order to effectively work with a lighting designer, you really need to understand what goes into lighting a show. You need to understand what lighting instruments are, what lighting designers go through when they light a show. How does a board work, right? What are the things that lighting designers do when they program? How do you speak the language of the lighting designer so that you can communicate effectively what it is you want? And it's really the same for everything. Stage management, sound, costumes. I have done each one of these jobs before in my life, many times. And it wasn't really until I had done all those jobs that I felt like I could maybe be a director too. So, but because I had done these things, I understood what goes into designing a costume or pulling costumes or building costumes. I understood what goes into sound design. I understood what goes into stage management. And I had an ability then to communicate what I wanted to each one of those design positions as I was formulating what my own vision was. So it's really important that the director be able to speak in all of those languages. You are dealing with all of these people all the time, and they are responsible for making sure that their artistic vision and your artistic vision gel together and seem cohesive. You really aren't just working with actors. That's only part of your job. So you have to be able to talk to everybody. And I would always say too, you have to be able to get along with people and compromise and realize that you are not a dictator, right? This is not rule by fiat. This is a collaborative process, and your idea isn't always the best idea. And so you also have to be able to collaborate and work with other people and make other people feel heard. And if you really strongly disagree with someone, be able to assert yourself in a way that's respectful, but you know, keeps the ship upright. Decision making. I was just talking to another friend of mine that I went to college with, who is also a director and a professor now, and we were talking about how directors are asked, they are decision makers, and they are asked to make so many decisions all the time. instantly, right? A lot of times, you know, you're brought a prop or three different props and you're like, you need to decide which one of these you like, because we need to buy this in the next couple days or else it won't be here in time, right? And as a director, you've got to be able to look at those and make a decision. It does not, there are two things that don't work for directors. One is just saying, I don't care, right? And not having a viewpoint. And the other one is having a viewpoint so specific that nothing is going to satisfy you. So you got to really find somewhere in the middle to be there, right? But you have to be able to make decisions. You cannot be a waffler. You've got to be able to look at things and have an opinion and choose one. And sometimes you realize later on, maybe that wasn't the best choice. Maybe you should have chosen the other one. But you learn from your mistakes, and you learn to live with what you've chosen too, because that's just the process. But there's a lot of decision making that goes into the directorial process. There are huge, if you don't like making decisions, don't become a director or a film director or a stage director, because there's a huge amount of decisions. And you are expected to have a thought and opinion about each one of those, right? And so your view has to be, like I said, specific enough that it feels good and that it has direction and a good creative feel and a clear thought, but open enough that you can also be adaptive. Because remember, again, theater is collaborative. You're working with lots of other people and you are often not going to get your first choice in things. You have to be able to make do with a second choice, and that has to be able to be workable as well. Managerial, you're managing a lot of people, right? You're making sure you're delegating tasks is another really important part of the directorial process, is being able to delegate. This is something it took me some time to learn. I kind of wanted to do everything. I wanted to have my hands in everything. And then, of course, after some years, I realized I will kill myself if I keep doing this. So you have to learn how to delegate and share the load and trust other people to get things done. And that's an important part of the process, is managing people, not being afraid to manage people, being a good manager, being fair, also trusting people to do their jobs. And if you can delegate and you can trust people and you get the right people around you, things will get done and things will get done correctly. But you have to be able to be there, and you cannot be asleep at the wheel, because people will need, throughout those 6 weeks that you're working intensely, and you're constantly reminding people of things. You're constantly checking in with people to make sure things got done and that they got done the way they were supposed to get done, because you're the person for all of that. And if you don't check in, then that person will not get checked in with, and you will end up with something not being done that might be very important. So managing people, delegation, all really important skills for the director. And then, of course, the creative skills that the director needs. The director needs a creative vision. They need to have that ability to be creative, to think creatively, to think outside of the box, to think in terms of visual elements, to see what the piece should look like, and to have that vision for it, and to be able to creatively interpret things, right? That's such an important part, because they are there guiding all of the other creative aspects of the play as well, you know? And so you have to be able to kind of think about each one of those and put those different hats on, right? Today I'm going to be helping the lighting designer, and I put on my lighting designer hat. And tomorrow I'm going to be helping the costumes and put my costume designer hat on, right? Lots of different roles the director plays, and ways that they help to support and contribute to the final production. Well, we are almost done with this section really quickly. I want to just catch Brittany has typed in today to answer the question of the day. Remember that the question of the day for extra credit is, what are some of the jobs of the director, and do you feel the director is a necessary part of the play production process? And Brittany says some of the jobs the director is responsible for are holding auditions to select the acting cast members, blocking the play by adapting the actor's movement to a workable floor plan on set, along with leading rehearsals while collaborating creatively with the actors and technical crew to make the blocking natural, changing it when necessary, and allowing inspiration. For these reasons and many more, I feel that the director is a necessary part of the play production process. Without the director, there would be no leader, and so many elements of a production wouldn't be the same. Absolutely, right? There are just so many elements now to coordinate that without that central person kind of unifying that, I think plays today would feel very disjointed and not unified. And I love that you say that they work to create these things, but they also change it when necessary, right? Again, that's just that part of being adaptable, being able to collaborate with others, recognizing when something isn't working, and then being able to change and do something different. That's really important to having a successful show, because you're working with so many different kinds of people. And, you know, just one example would be sometimes you're working with an actor and you're telling them what you want them to do or what you want them to, where they, you want them to go, and you can tell them 10 different times in 10 different ways and they still don't get it. And you have to be willing to hang in there and continue trying to find new ways to explain. I often say part of the job of a director is just knowing how to explain something in 10 different ways. And not getting tired of doing it and not getting frustrated. Because everybody speaks a different language, and it sometimes, because actors are artists as well, it is really can be very mysterious what is going to click for them, what's going to make sense for them, right? And so it's really important to be able to hang in there and to know how to communicate what it is you're thinking, what's inside of your head, in a lot of different ways, right? Not just the same way 10 times, 10 different ways, right? All right. Well, what the creative skills that the director needs are, as we're moving on here, the creative skills that the director needs come into play when we look at script selection. They're looking at all kinds of things when we're looking, when we are able to select a script, which we don't always get to do, right? We're thinking about all kinds of things like audience, budget, the talent that we have available to us, what you personally like, the main metaphor of the piece, the directorial concept or vision. We're also analyzing the script. We're looking at the pacing of the script, the characters, the time period, the themes, the structure, the genre, all of that as we're analyzing the script and thinking about how we might decide to produce it this time. We're there for design oversight and inspiration. Obviously, I just talked extensively about that with costumes, lights, sets, the overall tone and concept of the piece. We're there to coach actors, and we're there as well to stage the play, as you were saying, Brittany, to, you know, actually create the movement of the piece with the actors. There are managerial skills as well that the director needs. They need to be able to effectively schedule things. A lot of scheduling takes place as a director. You're scheduling auditions, you're scheduling read-throughs, rehearsals, production meetings, designer runs, paper text, dry text, tech week. when I'm directing, I have a very, very full calendar. It has a lot of things written in it, and there almost isn't a moment where I'm not doing something. If I do have downtime, I'm usually still doing something for the show, whether that be thinking about what needs to happen later on, or following up with people, or helping to look for something for props or set or something. So you've got to be really good at time management, and you need to be really good at creating schedules, understanding what is an effective schedule, and managing time effectively, but not just for yourself, for everybody, right? Because there's a lot that has to happen in a very short amount of time, and it has to happen effectively and efficiently. We're also going to record original blocking in our own scripts. We're going to create a contact sheet. We're going to help with publicity, and there may be even fundraising that directors, unfortunately, are asked to do. There's a lot of different aspects, and the director is involved in every single one of them. And they are there to, you know, be there from the inception all the way to the end product at the end. And hopefully it all comes out the way you thought it would. All right, we've got just a few minutes left here. And we're going to take some time here to kind of look at two different modern directors, Julie Taymor and Ivan Van Hove. These are two of my favorite directors, modern directors. Julie Taymor, definitely one of my all-time favorites. She's just a very, very talented human being. And she has been greatly influenced by Asian forms, mask work and puppetry. Very theatrical. Her most well-known play is probably The Lion King, which we talked about, right? Here she is actually working herself on one of the masks, for which she was the first woman to win a Tony Award as a director. Can you believe that? First woman to ever win a Tony in the position of director. Directing is still, it's been changing over the years, but for a very long time it was dominated by men. And in the professional world, there still is, it still is very dominated by men. And so it can be difficult as a woman to break into that and to insert, you know, your own vision and worldview. But Julie Taymor has certainly done that. She's an artist of just the highest degree. I love everything she does, even the things she fails at, like Spider-Man. I think she reaches for the stars and she still gets the moon, you know. So I want us to take a look. I know we probably will go a little bit over time today, which is okay. But I do want us to take a look at this interview with her. I think there's a lot of insight into the directing process. As we look at this and her process in particular, and I just admire her so much, I'd love to share this little clip with you as she's interviewed about her work and what she sees her work as being. So let's take a look at this clip of Julie Tamer.
People try and protect themselves and don't take risks. I find that boring in life. What I loved about my upbringing was that the dinner table was constant conversation about politics, art, history, books. It was a very vital family scene where they really were concerned about what was going on in the world. I think that theater bug was in the family. We always had tremendous theatrical events in the backyard or in the garage. I had a dress-up closet with a big box of antique clothes. Using our imagination and really putting on shows and stories was something I just had a knack for it and a desire to do it. I saw the power of theater to change lives as a very young woman in Indonesia. I went to Indonesia for 3 months and stayed 4 years. I was interested in myth, ritual, religion, classics. I was so unprepared for what I saw there and what I experienced. Phenomenal mask and puppetry on a very high, sophisticated level. And also, I had never been in a society, in a culture, where theater was the most important moving form, educationally and in entertainment simultaneously. They would be talking about birth control or the lack thereof or AIDS or whatever the important social issue of the time would be incorporated through improvisation into these dramas. That was the formative time for me. It was traveling into other walks of life. That is really what I think has made me that person who travels a road less traveled. It was so inspiring that it fed me and became very important in how I view what I do as an artist. You can go to a place you never knew you would go to before. You'd go to a place that people didn't know they want to go. And I want to make people see something that they didn't know that they were going to see or didn't know they even wanted to see. That after they've done it, they didn't know that they were going to have that feeling. And that's the most satisfying for me. I've had that experience, that satisfaction of that crossover with something like The Lion King. I got a call from Tom Schumacher at Disney Animation. And he said, do you know The Lion King, the movie? We're thinking of doing that in theater. I said, no, I mean, I've heard of it. Aesthetically, I have a radically different style than Disney. The whole airbrushed look is just not my world. But the actual stories that Disney deals with, they've never shied away from darkness. The challenge of it was the exciting part. The idea that, wow, there's no human beings, and yet there are. Characters are coming through these incredible faces. How can I put it on stage? We had our first performance, and the audience started screaming, just yelling and screaming through the whole thing. And whenever they liked something, we just broke into tears. The experience of being the first was fantastic. It was all thrilling. It was great from the moment the choreographer won, and then the lighting designer won, and then I got it for costumes. What makes it so successful is it transcends culture. It's a life story. It's a coming-of-age story. There's nobody who doesn't understand what it means to leave home because you're guilty and you have to come back again. It is a story that belongs to the world. The actual creation that you're creating is not just filling the seats for people to have a good 3 hour, 2.5 hour enjoyment, but sometimes it actually goes into what's going on in that person's life or that family's life and transforms them.
Wonderful. I just love that clip. I think, again, it gives us such an insight into her work and what brought her to where she is and how she creates what she creates. Again, she is, you know, has a specific vision. It's highly influenced by the time she spent in Indonesia and the time in Asia in general and the work she did there. You can see that she is also someone who has done a lot of stuff, right? You saw her dancing. You saw her making, she makes her own masks. She is a sculptor. She is an artist. And again, I think these are all things that are really important as a director. You can't just be somebody who hasn't done some of this stuff, right? You need to have those things in your repertoire of understanding so that you can also communicate what your vision is to these other artists. Okay, we're going to quickly look. I know we're going to go just a tiny bit over today, guys, but we are going to quickly look at Ivan Van Hove. And this is a gentleman who has a completely different style from Julie Taymor. He's a Belgian director, and he's known for his avant-garde off-Broadway productions, such as Arthur Miller's View from a Bridge, and most recently, The Crucible, he did. And he is known for reinterpreting these very kind of American classics in kind of radically different ways, right? We're not going to look at both of the clips that I have today. I just want to take a look at the Tony Awards clip. So the first clip, if we could take a look at that, which is the one from A View from a Bridge. Before we look at it really quickly, I just want to point out that Arthur Miller was writing in the 50s all the way into the 60s, I think even into the late 70s, and his pieces are considered classics of American theater. They're typically, off, except for The Crucible, really, they're these insights into the American family, into American ideals and character, and they're often done in a very gritty mix of realism with surrealism and fantasy, but they have a grounding in realism. And I think what Ivan Hove brings to this piece is he really emphasizes the more fantastical elements of Arthur Miller's pieces. He has a way of seeing things, because he is Belgian, he's not American, I think, of really seeing it through different eyes and allowing it to become a little bit more universal as a result. So let's take a look at this. This is a clip from his A View from the Bridge, his remounting of that. Obviously, it had been done on Broadway before, but he remounted it with a completely different vision. And I think we're going to see his style come through really, really clearly in his voice. And then maybe we'll just take a quick second at the end to kind of talk about what that is. So let's take a look at the Tony Awards clip for A View from a Bridge.
I worked like a dog 20 years so a punk could have it, so that's what I've done. I mean, in the worst times, you know? The worst, when there was no ships coming in the harbor, I didn't stand around looking for relief, I hustled. When there was empty piers in Brooklyn, I went to Hoboken and Staten Island, the West Side, Jersey, all over, because I made a promise. I took out of my own mouth to give to her. I took out of my wife's mouth. I walked hungry, plenty days in the city, and now I gotta sit in my own house and look at a son of a bitch punk like that, which she came out of nowhere. I'd give him my house to sleep. I'd take the blankets off my bed for him, and he takes and puts his dirty, filthy hands on it like a goddamn thief.
But Eddie, she's a woman now.
He's stealing from me.
But she wants to get married, Eddie. She can't marry you, can she?
What the hell are you talking about? I don't know what you're talking about.
I gave you my advice, Eddie. That's it.
All right. So, if you, probably none of you have ever seen a production of A View from a Bridge, but let me tell you, it's never been done like that, right? Very, very blank space, minimalist set. I mean, it's almost, you could, I mean, that barely almost qualifies for a set. I'm sure there's set designers out there getting very angry at me. But I mean, it's really nice. It's a wall with a doorway and then a blank space with some benches, right? And even the costumes, all very gray, black and kind of tones, shades of gray and white, right? The lighting, very cold. And it almost feels as though the entire thing is in black and white, right? And the feeling that gives to this piece that is really a family drama, which is really about these very American characters in this very, very blank, sterile space, is a very different feeling than and makes the audience focus on completely different aspects of the production than you would focus on if those people were set in a space that looked like an actual living room, right? A very realistic set, which is what you would typically see, right? And very realistic costumes. And so we can see that the vision of the director is integral to the ultimate interpretation of the piece and how, therefore, the audience receives the piece and what messages they're taking away from it. So the director has this kind of interesting power to focus the audience on a particular aspect of a show that they want them to look at more carefully. And they can do that in dramatic ways, as we saw with Van Hove, or they can do it in more subtle ways, as we might see with other directors. And it might vary from piece to piece. But the director's job is to have that vision, to work with other designers, collaborators, to enact that vision, and then to bring it to the audience and let them decide what they think ultimately, if that was successful or not. So, anyways, guys, we've gone over today. I'm so sorry about that, but I did want to get to that last piece so that you could kind of see these two different modern directors and how different they are and what they're bringing to the table. I want to remind you again, today and this week was focused on directing, not Angels in America. There's no quiz. Just do the discussion board for this week. I will extend the date of the discussion board out into next week so that you don't end up late on it because of the misunderstanding. Next week is Angels in America. There is a quiz and a discussion board. That quiz will be due not this Sunday, of course, but next Sunday. And the discussion board will be due during that time. And if you've already done it, fantastic. I do believe that's it. We only have one more class together. And after that, you will need to take the final. And I will be reminding you again. I think it opens next week sometime. You will have part of next week and then all finals week to take it. And I believe that's all for today. So thank you so much for tuning in. And I look forward to our last class next week as we talk about Angels in America. Thanks.